Hi, my name is Neha Mahajan. Today I will talk about the optical sources which are used in the optical fiber communication. So the topic is optical sources. The optical sources generate the optical signals which are transmitted inside the optical fibers, and the basic function of the optical sources is to convert the electrical energy into the optical energy in an effective manner so that they can be transmitted inside the optical fiber in an effective way. Before we go into the actual discussion of optical sources and its types and also its working principle, let us talk about the various desirable characteristics of an optical source. An optical source should fulfill certain requirements so that it can transfer the optical energy in the optical fiber in an effective way. The first and the foremost desirable characteristic is that the optical source should be having a narrow beam width. The first one is narrow spectral width or narrow beam width. In order to minimize the dispersion inside the optical fibers. The second desirable characteristic is that the optical sources should emit the light in a certain wavelength regions only, which are called as the low dispersion region. So they should emit the optical signals in low loss windows. We have three kinds of low loss windows, that they are known as first window, second window and third window inside the optical fibers, where the attenuation is minimum, and those optical windows work at 850 nanometer, at around 1310 nanometer and 1550 nanometer respectively. So in other words, in order that the optical sources should couple the light effectively, they should emit the optical signals at these particular wavelengths only. But here 850 nanometer is now obsolete these days, so we will be talking essentially only about 1310 nanometer and 1550 nanometer. The third desirable characteristic is that the optical fiber should be capable of transmitting adequate amount of optical energy inside the optical fiber. So next is the capability to transmit sufficient power such that even after encountering all types of attenuations and dispersion inside the fiber, still after reaching the far end of the fiber, the optical signal is capable to drive the detector circuit. The next characteristic is that it should be linear. Another thing is that the optical sources should be highly rigid, they should be flexible, and they should not show much variation in their characteristics with the variation in the temperature and with the moisture. So these are the various desirable characteristics of an optical source. So hence, although we have quite a broad range of optical sources which are available, but because of these desirable characteristics, the choice becomes limited. So accordingly, the optical sources can be broadly classified into two categories. The first one is the gas sources, that means laser, Laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. The main characteristics of the gas sources or lasers are that they give high output. They have a very narrow spectral width. And their radiation pattern is very directional. But this cost is very high. So this is the direction pattern of a laser. It gives high output, but the beam width or the spectral width is very narrow. It is in the range of 0.2 to 3 nanometer. Whereas the second category is the semiconductor sources. Under semiconductor optical sources, we have LED, that means light emitting diode, and ILD, that means injection laser diode. Their main characteristics are that they give low output power, they have a very broad spectrum width, and their radiation pattern is not directional. So it is non-directional radiation pattern. So that's the case of a LED. The spectral width is quite broad. It is in the range of 30 to 50 nanometer. So they are not suitable for the single mode fibers where the optical core radius is very, very small. So they cannot be effectively coupled with the single mode fibers. Now looking at these characteristics, the first two desirable characteristics of the optical sources are satisfied by the gas sources, but looking at the other remaining characteristics, the semiconductor sources also appear to be the appropriate ones. Next, I will talk about the Before talking about the basic principle of LED and laser, let us talk about the basic concepts of emission and absorption in semiconductor substances. When the electron is in the lower energy state, let's say E1, and we want to make it jump from the lower energy state to the higher energy state, we can supply the stimulus in the form of an external photon having an energy E is equal to the difference between the two energy level, that is E2 minus E1. It can jump from the lower energy state to the higher energy state. So this becomes the initial state, and after absorbing the photon, the electron jumps to the higher energy state. This mechanism is called as the stimulated emission. Stimulated absorption. Here the photon energy E is given by E2 minus E1 and that is equal to h nu or hc by lambda, where h is the Planck's constant, which is equal to 6.626 into 10 raised to power minus 34 joule second. C is the velocity of light in vacuum, that is 3 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second, and lambda is the emitted light. This was about the stimulated absorption. Now there's one more case in which initially the electron is in the higher energy state. Here the electron is already in the higher energy state E2, and it can return to the lower energy state by releasing certain amount of energy in the form of a photon by liberating the energy, which is equal to again the difference between the two energy levels. So here it can come down to the lower energy state in any random fashion, and this kind of liberation of energy is called as the spontaneous emission. This kind of mechanism is supported by the optical sources like LED. Here, the liberation of photon is in a random manner, so it liberates energy in the form of incoherent radiations. So this liberation can be either in the form of a photon, which is called as radiative recombination, or else it can be in the form of heat, which is called as non-radiative recombination. And there's one more case in which the electron in the higher energy state does not come down to the lower energy state spontaneously or automatically. Rather, it has to be stimulated with the help of external stimulus in the form of a stimulating photon. So this stimulating photon is again having an energy equal to the difference between the two energy levels, and this stimulating photon will bring it down to the lower energy level, resulting into the formation of one more photon. So ultimately we have two photons. One is stimulating photon, the one which generated it, and the one which has been created in this entire process, and that is called as stimulated photon. Now the interesting property about these photons is that both of them tend to have the similar energy. Because of their identical energy, they tend to have equal amount of frequency. They also have similar states of polarization, and they travel in the same phase. That's the reason it results into the coherent radiations. This phenomena of stimulated emission is supported by the laser. So hence laser produces the coherent radiations in case of an optical fiber. Thank you. I stop here. Thanks for watching this video.